Now, in the opening few weeks of any electrical program, you'll be expected to do a health and safety element. And within there, there'll be one called identifying hazards. Now, it would be great to jump into something like this, an enclosure with no cover on it. We've got a Wago 221 connector there in the bottom left-hand corner, which might mean nothing to you. And we can see that some of the red conductors in there have started to overheat and maybe char. There are conductors that aren't connected. There's no green and yellow sleeving on the CPC. And it looks like you could write and write and write. However, your knowledge might be just turning up at college and you have no experience of the electrical system. So as you look at picture number two, the obvious thing to us is there is a risk of electric shock due to the fact there is no cover on it. And you can see maybe the very bottom there where the MCBs are connected to what is a brass bus bar, often called buzz bar, but it is a bus bar. There's no guard in front of that. So in this case, we could easily receive electric shock. Now, it would be great to start describing maybe the cables are too long, but is that dangerous and is that a hazard? That's maybe something later on in your study program. We've got another one here with a more industrial feel. And again, you might be now struggling as a new person to college to work out what might or might not be safe about this part of the installation. So of course, as we work through these images, we're going to work towards this type of scenarios you'd be expected to identify in the first 4 weeks of a college setting. This might be something you experience maybe at home, or a family friend has done a little bit of DIY and drilled through a cable in the wall and you've exposed it out, and you can see now that we've actually damaged that cable and that cable would need be replacing. We've got another consumer unit here, and hopefully this time your eye is being drawn over to the right hand side where you can see some overheating. That overheating could have been caused by a connection that was under tight or over tight. And as you work your way through your course, you'll see how important it is to return screws within consumer units, something at the moment you might call fuse boards, to the required torque setting. But remember, this is the first 4 weeks. Are you going to be able to see things like this in college? Probably unlikely. Again, an overheated termination. Maybe it's both the line and neutral that were under tight, say, for instance, and we've generated a lot of heat, and this is on the back of an electric oven. We've got a plug top here, something you'll make off in those early few weeks at college, and it's been made off with, first of all, the wrong cable, and hopefully with limited knowledge, you might be able to see that we've got incorrect polarity. That means at this stage we've got conductors around the wrong way. So if we look at the blue one there, it goes into where the fuse is 13 amps. That should be our line conductor and that should be brown. And if you look on the other side, we've got the brown one going into where the neutral should be housed. Our green and yellow one does go into the protective conductor terminal within the plug itself, but it's a load of things wrong with it. And it could be that you'd have to identify those as hazards in that first 4 weeks at study. Now, this gentleman here, Ben, came to me at 16 years old. And when he first came to me, yes, we did health and safety for 4 weeks, and he had to walk around with an empty plastic box, erect a ladder, scaffold tower, and identify hazards and do safe isolation. He also came back in his 30s and had another go at the program and completed it this time as an adult. And believe it or not, the first 4 weeks were identical. So Ben went through this process twice. The students we've got here have obviously got the great excitement to meet in the wonderful Thomas Nagy when he came to college. But these third year learners also had to go through the following part of the syllabus that required them to identify hazards. So we jump into the electrical workshop. This is something that's been staged, and you'd be expected after 4 weeks to be able to look in here and see basic safety errors. So things that are hazardous with limited knowledge. We've barried off the area because obviously we don't want students to walk into that area, but this is what we're going to look at here for identifying hazards within a college setting. Look at the picture now, and we're scanning across the floor. We're looking at the walls. We'll probably come back to those. So we're going to look at what's close to us first of all. Well, we've got a wooden stepladder. That's not a problem. It would be nice to be fiberglass. Remember, there's budgets available in college that are limited, but we can see rope that attaches the front and back frame is broken on the side nearest to us, and it looks like it has a knot in the other side. So of course that would be an easy hazard to identify to us as learners in the first 4 weeks of our program. We've also got stuff on the floor that can cause trip hazards. So what students end up doing is overthinking this section when they have to write down the hazards they can see within a work area. We can clearly see more stuff on the floor, so that's something we're going to need to pick up when identifying hazards in the area. You might now be focusing on the chair. Why is the chair in this area? Might be that the lecturer has left it behind, or it might be they want you to say, is someone potentially going to use that to access working at height? We saw the steps that were incorrect, but is that there? And potentially somebody could work on that. So we've also got a piece of wood there on the ground, and you probably can't quite see it. So I'll bring it into a little bit more into focus in this shot here. Hopefully you can see that piece of wood. And now we're seeing lots of stuff on the floor and a piece of wood that can be a danger. Again, this could be a trip hazard. But if you really focus in on it, you can see that there is a nail poking through it. So we'd be expected to identify that as a hazard on a sheet given to us if we say had to find 10 hazards within a work area. As your eye line jumps up, we've also got some chemical solutions there. So you'd have to lean in and see what that is. It's likely that that doesn't want to be in the environment and would like to be stored in maybe a steel container or somewhere safely. It certainly doesn't want to be left around where people can easily access it. We've got more stuff on the floor. So it's simple stuff you're looking for when working through these images in order to identify hazards in a work area. And as we look here, now we can focus in on the consuming that we saw in the opening section of this, and we can use some of that knowledge we've drawn on. So we've got no cover on it. Let's make it nice and simple. So we can obviously access the actual terminals within there, and we can see there is no guard there on the brass bus bar that would prevent people from touching it. Now, my students would often go on and say the circuit is protected by an AC RCD, Gaz, and that needs to be an A type. Yeah, it certainly does. And it's a conversation we've had many times in the workshop, but we're trying to pick out the very easy wins here when identifying safety. The other one they used to love was the fact the IP rating on the top surface was not IP4X. Therefore, objects with a diameter greater than 1 mil could not enter the top of the enclosure. Well, we can see there's 20 and 25 mil holes knocked out at the top. So of course it hasn't got IP4X on the top surface, and I always let them get away with that one as an excellent thing to pick up in the first 4 weeks. And also you'd have the student that say the bottom of the electrical enclosure is not IP2X. In other words, we can stick our index finger in there. We go on and talk about IPXXB, but we're drifting away from the actual hazards we identify there. The hazards I'd want from this one are the fact there is no cover on the front, and if the cover wasn't on the front, there is no guard over the bus bar, more than the extent that people would go into with my students when they're talking about some of these enclosures. Again, as we look here, we've got another consumer with the cover on, but then you've got to start thinking, is there any other hazards? That's maybe where we come with the holes on the top, or maybe some blanks are missing on that one there. So as we zoom into it, we can clearly see now that that consumer unit, regardless of whether there's RCD protection, etc., the fact that the blanks are missing from the front and somebody could put their fingers in there is the hazard that want to be identified at this stage. We see the light fitting within the area as well. There's a couple here to focus in on. You can see at the very top where the flex comes out of the ceiling rows that actually we can see the two conductors, and our insulation is not brought into the fitting. That probably means the cord grip is not being used correctly up there. And as we lower our eyes down, there is actually part of the pendant missing here. So the bit that would cover the terminals for line and neutral are missing. So there's two that I'd expect them to pick up there. Somebody else would say it's not an energy efficient lamp. That's not a hazard. That's just a matter of fact in that situation. Another one here, our students would often overthink this. It just takes a little glance up to see that the actual cover is missing off the trunking, and we'd like them to identify that as a hazard. So just bear in mind, your first 4 weeks of studies, you'll be expected to look at either photographs or a staged environment in order that you can identify hazards. Please do not overthink it. Please go for the most obvious things on the list that you need to build. If you want to know more about safe isolation and GS38, check out the video on screen now.